Good morning. I'm the deputy managing editor for investigations at the agency. So I'm not an attorney, but I guess I'm what you would call a power user of the law. I think we probably do more with the law than any news organization in the state, and certainly are responsible for a lot of litigation over the law. So we had a very deep interest in seeing how the law was written and making sure it was, you know, as user-friendly as possible. We started without giving you a little bit of climate, so I want to give you a little bit of national climate here, so you'll sort of understand where some of the open records things came from. The trend across the land right now is not, to be perfectly honest, to strengthen or improve open government laws. And at a time when mistrust of government is at a pretty all-time high, that's sort of an astounding climate. I'm involved in a couple of professional organizations that look at sunshine laws, and this year when I went up to investigative reporters and editors and spoke about our new law and what the Attorney General had done here and how he had led the way for improving the law, folks were pretty astounded. I think there is going to be, because of the sense of mistrust of government, more momentum around this area, and I think it's becoming more of a bipartisan area. That actually was what was fairly extraordinary about the passage of this law, was that it was, I think it was unanimous in the Senate and pretty darn close to unanimous in the House, which for a legislature that exempts itself from the law, that's pretty astounding. And especially when you start dealing with different committee chairs and others, and you find out that a lot of them are in fact attorneys for a city council here or a county government there or whatever. So it was a pretty pretty profound success in the legislature. I do think the meetings part of the law is an area that Attorney General Owens is really passionate about. He, having been in local government, I think felt that there is more abuse of that law than actually, you know, maybe we know or are aware of. At the newspaper and at the media level, we were all concerned about documents and worrying really very deeply about the public records aspect of the law, because that's what we use. But the meetings law is probably the case where the place where private citizens tend to intersect a little bit more. So I'll walk through that law. As Holly said, it's not going to be as detailed or as long as the documents part, because quite honestly, there weren't as many changes, and it's just not as big a part of the law. One of the things that is different is that in the old law, you sort of had your Records Act and your Meetings Act, and now they are put together in a way that's more coherent and makes sense and has some parallels between the two laws. So we'll talk about that some. There were some places where documents were maybe exempted, but discussions about them were public or other things like that. So big picture sort of global view, the meetings law is very, very strong. What is open is basically all meetings of government bodies. So, you know, city, county, state, library, school board, tremendous amounts of government are open. There are a few notable exceptions we'll talk about, but in general, especially at the local level, the agencies, meetings of commissions and boards are open. And also, and this is an important thing to note, also they're committees. So if you have a quorum of a committee meeting, on an issue, then that is open as well. It's not just the quorum of the full board. Just by way of a little bit of background, what the changes are in the open meetings law, a lot of them came about because the Attorney General started out with a very strong position on the open meetings aspect of the law. He really wanted to change it so that if two people meet and do business, two people of a government agency meet and do business, that's the public's business. They're paid by the government, and they're doing public business, and so that's the government's business. The local governments pushed back on that tremendously, because I think they felt like the risk was so great that if you had coffee with a friend and you ended up talking a little bit of business, you could find yourself dragged to court. They really pushed back on that. So a lot of the changes that are in here are to make it much clearer that when business is going on, no matter what it is or where it is covered by the law, And when business is not going on, and there are reasonable times when the, you know, when government agencies sort of intersect, and business is not going on, but that's not really what the law was intended to affect. So we'll talk a little bit more about it. So as I said, all the local government agencies, most of the boards and commissions of state government are open. Also the nonprofits, this mirrors the documents law. The law used to say nonprofits that receive a significant amount of government funding. Now it's a third for clarity. So I think that helps, and maybe a little bit better than we expected on that. What is not covered? There are some huge gaps in who the legislature, of course, exempts itself from the open meetings and the open records laws. It's really a big issue on open records. It's less so on meetings because by tradition, the legislature is open and public except for conference committees. If you know the legislature, conference committees are often where a lot of work is done, so we'd like to see that change too. But it is less of an issue. Judicial proceedings are open under common law, as you know, but they are not covered. You know, the open records and open meetings is really an executive branch kind of law. It applies to not legislative and not judicial. But judicial meetings are, of course, open by tradition and common law. Law enforcement, one of the new changes, inspection of physical facilities was in the old law, now as property as well. So if you go out and inspect a building, that's not a meeting of the county commission. Now it's also if you inspect a lot, I guess. Statewide or regional training meetings is a new exemption. It's basically where the idea where all the county commissions from all over the state go off and learn. No offense to anybody in here, but what we suspect they learn is how not to comply with open records law from time to time. They don't let us in those for some reason. Meetings with legislative and executive branch in state or federal offices, that was actually in the old law but got changed because of what they called the City of Atlanta exemption. In the old law, you had to travel outside of your jurisdiction for a meeting with a legislative or executive branch. So if the Atlanta City Council went and met with the governor, then their meeting had to be public because they didn't travel outside their jurisdiction. But if the Gwinnett County Commission met with the governor, then that was closed because they were traveling outside. So now it's all meetings with legislative or executive branch in the state or federal offices. These are primarily those kind of courtesy visits where the agency goes and talks about the legislative agenda or what's on the governor's mind, that kind of thing. Travel to a meeting, they don't have to put us in the car with them. If there are three people in a quorum in the car, we don't get to ride along with them to the meeting. Civil ceremonial functions, as long as no business is conducted. And this is really what I was talking about trying to make the law a little bit more practical. If all of the county commission goes to the funeral of a long-time deceased employee of the county, if they're not doing business, no one's trying to make that an open meeting. Now, if they're using that opportunity to go have meetings and votes and do business, that's another thing. Also new is mediation. That was something that was sometimes unclear in the old law. It's very clearly called out now that if there's mediation, the civil lawsuit, settlement talks, that kind of thing, that they are, that the activity is allowed to be exempted. The result is not allowed to be exempted. Okay, so executive session under the law is a legally closed portion of the meeting. First of all, there should be no legally closed meetings in their entirety. The meeting has to be open, and then the body has to vote to go into executive session. So if you're hearing, oh, it's a closed meeting, don't come, or don't know what it is, that's a problem. They're supposed to convene a public meeting and then vote to go into executive session. So executive session is a portion of the meeting. The reasons that they can close a meeting are not radically changed, although there are a few new exceptions into there. Attorney-client privilege stuff, when the county attorney is giving the commission legal advice, that's always been closed. Personnel matters in general have been closed, and that really applies to specific personnel matters. So we'll talk about that in a minute, but one of the things that they used to be on payroll was could they interview agency heads in executive session, and the answer is yes. Now under the law, it's clear that they can interview, not hire, not make an offer, but actually interview agency heads. Discussion of records exempted from public records law, if there's no reasonable way to discuss them without disclosing. This was a new exemption that, honestly, I think that the cities and counties wanted it. It kind of bothers us because we think it's a little vague. But if they're going to have a discussion about a record that is presumably private, includes, you know, law enforcement information or student names or stuff like that, and under the old law they tended to discuss those in public but not name the names or not cite the private parts of the conversation. Now if there's no other way to do that without naming the information that's in the exempted document, they can have a closed session to do that. Real estate acquisition, as Tom said, was unclear a little bit, and we had a bad court ruling on that front that had made it even muddier. Real estate acquisition in most jurisdictions in the state was allowed to be discussed behind closed doors, but was voted on in public. There were some jurisdictions where it was not voted on in public. It is now the law of the land that real estate acquisition should be a public vote. The intent for that is pretty clear, I think. If the county's going to buy some property and they announce we're looking to buy some property along Henderson Mill Road, then everybody out there is going to go jack up the prices. It's going to cost the taxpayers more. You understand that for efficiency and especially saving taxpayers money, there needs to be some private negotiations up front, but the vote should always be public in the terms of the vote. They can't just say we vote to buy this property. They need to tell you what they bought it for. Same with settlement negotiations. Yeah, I said mediation is now allowed to be held in private, but the vote must be taken in public. So if there's a settlement discussion between two parties in dispute with a government, and then, you know, the attorney gets a compromise, like work out a compromise, then the vote should still be public. And finally, I said the interviews of executive heads of agencies are allowed to be private. Those are the top people of like a department. They're not, you know, everybody, but usually the boards don't interview everybody. Okay, the process for an executive session. This has changed a little bit, but not radically. As I said, the meeting itself should start open, and then there should be a motion to go into executive session. And there needs to be a majority of a quorum to go into executive session with the reason specified. What is the exemption under the law that they're going into executive session? Obviously, the reason can't be so detailed that it reveals the confidential information, but it needs to be detailed enough that a reasonable public person could understand it. As Tom mentioned previously, under the new law now, while they're in executive session, minutes are kept. That is not because they're routinely disclosed afterward, but because if there is a challenge, there's an opportunity to review that. If for some reason during the executive session, the conversation goes off course and gets into an area that is not properly closed or starts going to another topic, the presiding officer should say that's not what we, you know, went into closed session to do. Stop having that conversation. If the conversation continues, the presiding officer, who is going to have to sign the affidavit, is supposed to rule that out of order and close off the executive session, open it back up, I guess we adjourn it. And then all votes must be taken in public session. There should never be any votes in private session. And ultimately, an affidavit that says the reason for the executive session needs to be signed and reported. And that affidavit is public. The presiding officer used to have to sign it. So if it was a committee, the committee chair, if it was the full board chair. Under the new law now, the presiding officer can ask every member present to sign it, which I think you know, maybe limit some bad behavior by some people when they were going in executive session and talking out of school. Now the presiding officer can say, I'm going to make you sign the affidavit too. So that should help. Some really important key changes that have I think, helped for folks who are challenging the meeting. The time to challenge a meeting is now extended to up to 6 months after the illegal activity. I think it was three before. And also it's, you know, it's after the vote of the activity. So it allows the activity to become public before. You don't have to know to challenge something before it becomes public, which in the old law there is some possibility of that. Again, all votes must be taken in public. Teleconferences are allowed in emergency, but they must be open. So if a citizen wants to join a teleconference, they can. I think that's going to be a little bit in dispute over time, depending on how much teleconference meeting goes on, because for most agencies, every new person they add to the phone call costs money. And so it's not a big deal for the occasional emergency meeting where one or two citizens want to dial in. But for agencies that, you know, maybe statewide agencies that meet exclusively by teleconference, that's sort of being worked through. Also, there is a new segment in the law that if you're, you know, if you're a board member and you're sick, you can dial into a meeting, or if you have doctor's excuse, there's limits on that. You can't do it, you know, you can't make it a habit to do that every time. But if you, if you're a public official who wants to make the meetings as regular as possible, and there's some reason you can't make an on-site meeting, there is an opportunity to dial into a meeting. The enforcement and penalties are the same as for records. So just to review on that, it's not just a criminal penalty anymore. There's now a civil penalty as well. The standards of proof are lower for the civil penalties than they are for the criminal penalties. So it's negligence for the civil penalty. It's the criminal penalty has a good faith defense, and I guess the standard is closer to sort of knowing and willful violation. That allows anyone who's challenging a meeting, it's not just the AG, but anyone can seek civil remedies here. It's a big deal. You know, the truth is that the idea that we could get the sheriff to go swear out a warrant and arrest someone on criminal charges in the past, as Tom said, just didn't ever happen. And so it happened, you know, that the civil remedies give us quite more for that. The two last areas I want to cover are really related to both records and meetings, have a lot of overlap, and so I wanted to put those in the end. One is the executive heads of agencies and sort of when they have to become public, because they're allowed to interview and have, you know, the winnowing out process is allowed to be private, but at some point it's supposed to become public so that the citizens have the opportunity to comment on the finalists for the job and say, oh yeah, they'd be great, or no, we don't think they'd be good, or whatever. The law now says, and the law has always said, that the candidates for executive heads of agencies, the documents related to them, their resumes and all that, can be kept secret until 14 days before the vote, at which point up to three finalists are supposed to be identified. Now, if the agency only has two finalists, that's fine. But if they have five finalists, then by the time they get to this public period, they need to narrow it to the top three. The way the process works, if you can imagine, if you're applying to be a police chief in Atlanta and you're the police chief in Dallas, you don't really want it to get out that you're looking right away, right? You really only want it to get out if you think you're going to get the job, or preferably, I'm sure, when you get. So, but we don't want the city of Atlanta to hire the Dallas police chief without the citizens of Atlanta having an opportunity to know that person's being considered. So the agency at the point where they've narrowed it to three finalists, basically they go to their finalists and they say, okay, now there's going to be a public period where your name and your candidacy could become public. Do you want to be a finalist? And if they say no at that point and they withdraw, then they don't get my public help. But if they do say yes, I'll be a finalist, then at that point they're subject to disclosure. The Board of Regents, perhaps knowing they were in a search for a new agency head, I'm not entirely sure what the motivation was, when came and got that changed to 5 days for them. So the window is 14 days for other boards and commissions, but 5 for the Board of Regents. The other thing, and Tom mentioned this, is disciplinary investigations. So if an employee is being disciplined in the board or the committee of the board is the people hearing that and deciding what to do, which is often the case with top heads. Disciplinary action, once the disciplinary investigation is concluded and the board or commission is presented with the findings and given the opportunity to say, okay, we're going to fire this person or we're going to let them stay, those records become public 10 days after the disciplinary action is presented, whether they're fired or not. So if they say, okay, we don't think there's anything here, we're not going to act on this, the records become public, or if they fire them, they become public. We often tell folks when someone's fired, you know, we say it's going to become public. The records are going to be public in 10 days anyway. If there's not any reason to hold them for 10 days, you may as well go ahead. It's just a news tip. If you're an attorney for an agency and, you know, they're trying to manage the news cycle, it's much better when they fire the guy, not have speculation out there for 10 days wondering why he was fired, and then another news story. Just go ahead and release the records right away if they're going to become public anyway. That's really the gist of the meetings changes. And we'll do questions. I am going to let Tom answer the questions because I'm not an attorney and I don't want to give y'all any legal advice. I'll be happy to give you news advice if you ever want any of that. And if you have news tips or you have stories about agencies that are not combined with the law, we're always interested in that.
Sure.
When I talk about hiring the executive head of the agency, do you have any insight to what, I noticed they added the term office. What did they mean by that when you're talking about it, the state or the
closer up? So there was a lot of discussion about executive head of an agency. What exactly does it mean? They, at the early draft of the law, had various titles, and then we decided that title inflation could make that very confusing as well. So basically there was a decision to stay with executive head of an agency.
Right.
I interpret that as meaning the top official for each an agency. But I have to concede that it is not a perfectly clear, there's no defined term, and it's not intuitively clear in every situation.
But then on down in the definition of agency, they specifically added the term office when they're referring to counties and municipalities and other political subdivisions.
I agree. And I think the addition of the term office was not done in concert with the idea of executive head of an agency. I do think the term office was simply trying to make sure that the idea of an agency encompassed every form of government. But I wish I had some insight for you on that. I really don't. That's going to be an issue that will continue to be some friction on that going forward.
Mm-hmm. Recently, there's been a controversy with Martin, and there was one of the people heading the search committee just asked for opinions about who her colleagues thought were viable, and that was alleged to be a violation of the Records Act. What was the alleged violation there? And can you not ask a friend for an opinion in an email?
So I think that's an excellent situation that gets right at the margins of the law. So on the argument that it is a violation of the Open Records Act is one of the very purposes of the Open Meetings Act, one of the very purposes of the Open Meetings Act was to make sure, and particularly with the revisions to the Open Meetings Act, that all voting took place in public, that all voting was a meaningful event for the citizens of the state, in that they got to see how their officials were voting on a particular issue, and that it wasn't just a sham vote, it wasn't just a hollow ceremony, but that they were actually going to see the way their officials were voting. So I think the concern is that when an email goes out like that saying, how is everybody going to vote, it is essentially, the vote is actually taking place in behind closed doors through this email chain, and that the voting itself, the public voting that is required, is undermining the entire process of having public voting. So that's the argument in favor of it being a violation. The argument against it being a violation is that there is a notion that in the act that you can have for exceptions under the Open Meetings Act, including voting on land, you can have discussions behind closed doors, including an exception to the Open Meetings Act for deliberation about the selection of an executive head of an agency or other employee. And that deliberation should include about, you know, a healthy discussion among the members of the governing board of the agency about what steps they're going to take. The question to me is, can you really take a vote in advance of the vote? And that's essentially what was occurring there. And so I think the question is that crossing the line? I do believe that that is crossing the line. In other words, I think you can have deliberations and discussions, but that the voting should be reserved for the voting in public on the candidate.
Well, wasn't the vote to be held in public, and wasn't the just asking for an opinion on, you know, her opinion, I mean, asking for everybody's opinion on who they thought was the more qualified candidate? If you're asking for an opinion, do you get around it? Or if you're just saying it's a vote, I want your vote now, that's one thing, but if you're asking their opinion of the candidate, that's something different?
And I think you can get around it? I think you can't. Do I think they may have crossed, I do think they crossed the line there, and that they're asking for a vote. They're essentially transforming the voting process into just a hollow one.
I think they even said,
I want your vote.
Well, I think they said, I want your vote, but I think they also later said, well, certainly we were going to have a unanimous public vote no matter what was decided privately.
And that is the process that where if voting becomes simply a sham where government seems constantly to be in agreement, it's undermined the whole concept of public voting.
Sure. The question I would have is if you are selecting one, two, or three people to fill board of director slots, is that exempt from this application?
No, but it's actually the reverse of that.
Where is that covered in here?
So under the Open Meetings Act, under the old law and the new law, let me back up. You can obviously discuss and deliberate in secret about the selection of employees.
They're not employees.
Right, exactly. And then the vote takes place in public. The Open Meetings Act actually makes clear that for candidates for the executive head for the governing body of the agency itself, that is supposed to take place in public. In other words, that is a public part. That is a public part of the discussion. The same protection for employees doesn't apply. And that's actually in the language of the act itself. I don't have it at my fingertips, but it does discuss the distinction between discussing an employee and discussing somebody who's going to take a seat on the governing board of the agency.
Mm-hmm. That's an open record question. Taking those questions too, I guess.
Sure.
If the request is made by email, the time starts with email is sent as opposed to some proof that was read in later day.
Correct. In other words, one of the things the new act is particularly good about is saying you a government agency cannot say the custodian was on a vacation or otherwise unavailable, so the date will only start when that individual came back into the office. The new act is very clear about saying, no, it's going to start when it was received by the agency. So the only thing that makes me hesitate about your question is it's not when it was sent, but when it is received. Obviously, for all of us, generally email is received very shortly, a matter of microseconds after it's sent, barring some unusual development.
If it's sent on a Friday afternoon, you got a Monday holiday or something like that. The practice is what it's trying to set you up. It's a business
day. Right, so it's 3 business days after receipt. So
you'll have about 3 days.
Right, exactly. Yes, exactly. So, and so that's, I just want to make sure everybody caught that. When we say 3 days, we are saying 3 business days. In other words, your weekend and your vacation are not counted. So the agency does have an opportunity to respond even if a message gets sent on a Friday over a long holiday.
And I'll just add to that, just so you know, all reporters do get counseled to put a reply receipt on open records requests. So they can tell me to the minute when it was received by the agency and when it was read by the agency. So just be aware that they're sticking those on their request when they go by email.
Mm-hmm. In your opinion, how widely or narrowly is the term acquisition to be construed with respect to the acquisition of real estate? Does that mean purchasing the real estate, leasing the real estate, or is it more widely construed?
I can tell you, I think the Georgia Court of Appeals, and I would expect the same for the Georgia Supreme Court, has been pretty willing to be generous in making sure that the Open Records Act process is not being used as a tool to take advantage of the marketplace for land by individuals. In other words, I do think there's going to be a fair amount of protection for agencies in their acquisition of property, and that acquisition will be interpreted. My expectation would be interpreted broadly in any situation where a government got concerned that if a request was being used to try and develop a profile of land that was potentially valuable to the requester. And I think, as I see it, with respect to the acquisition of land, the courts do not want the agencies to be operating at a disadvantage from other citizens, because ultimately the best price benefits all of us.
I was more concerned about the meetings.
Okay.
Rather than that, where the acquisition is contingent or extremely attenuated from the transaction that's being specifically discussed. For instance, where the municipality gains kind of a security interest, if they're guaranteeing bonds, which are defaulted upon, they get the land. I think that's really stretching the point, particularly if it's a piece of remedial legislation, and exceptions should be construed narrowly.
So I think that's a very valid point, and so let me explain a little bit what I think you're getting at, and it is a problem, and that is that increasingly government agencies enter negotiations and discussions in which they will have a lot of aspects to them, and land will be some small portion of the larger discussion, whether it's an economic development deal, and remember economic development The exception we talked about is only for the State Department of Economic Development. Whether it's an economic development deal, whether it is government helping out some local organization, the property aspect of it will be a minor one, and yet they'll try and obscure the entire deal, conceal the entire arrangement, because by using the property exception. I agree that that is an issue. I do think that is a situation where if it seemed abusive, the courts would be more restrictive on the idea of an acquisition, of what acquisition means. But I don't think, unfortunately, there's never really been a decision on that issue. I've run into that issue, candidly, with respect to Piedmont Park. Piedmont Park, the Atlanta Botanical Garden, all of those organizations are at the heart of the city of Atlanta's largest public park. There's various charities that work with them. There will sometimes be complex deals that involve a land exchange, and the entire discussion, they'll argue, should be sealed off because some small aspect of them involves a land exchange. I agree that I think that is stretching the concept of the exception for acquisition too far, but I can't say that there's any legal authority I'm aware of on that subject.
Thank you.
This is a question with regard to the Open Records Act. Suppose you have an agency that maintains records that right now are subject to disclosure under the Act, but they are asked to enter into a partnership with other governmental agencies whereby they would contribute data to a study that would otherwise be exempt under FERPA. How do you then deal with the information that that agency maintained that is not exempt, but is now being contributed as a part of the overall data study that is now protected under FERPA? Does that kind of make sense?
It does. You guys are very good at coming up with complex questions maybe beyond my ability to answer in this context. I guess my answer would be that I think that information that is protected by FERPA will be a valid exception under the new law, but that the constituent pieces that went into creating the information that is ultimately protected by FERPA are not necessarily protected under the law. And one thing I want to emphasize, there's probably some people in this room, but not all, sort of what FERPA is. FERPA is what protects our individual educational records. In other words, what if I had gone to University of Georgia, it would be the law that requires my consent before any individual could go to the University of Georgia and say, I would like to see Tom Clyde's transcript. I'd like to see Tom Clyde's other educational records. Even though University of Georgia is a public institution, if somebody's asking about the individual records of an individual student, FERPA will now prevent them from disclosing those records. And I think we all are comfortable with that idea. At the same time, I think we all recognize it's very important, particularly in this state and particularly given the challenges that we faced, that data about how large bodies of students are doing, whether it's at the post-secondary, secondary, or earlier than that level, is very important to us understanding whether our educational system is succeeding. We have to know how students are performing as large groups. The rub, the difficulty, is when you start breaking it down into small enough groups where there's a risk that an individual student might be identifiable. And so the United States government, which administers FERPA, has tried to make rules about when small enough groups create what they call an easily traceable pattern to an individual. And so this concept that something, if it's easily traceable, if the data set is so small that it's easily traceable to figure out who Tom Clyde is, then it's arguably protected by FERPA. But large bodies of data about the performance of students are available today. they were available under the old open records law, they will be available under the new open records law, and that's very important for us monitoring how the system's performing.
I have a question about an agency employee with personal email accounts or personal cell phone text messages. Can you comment on whether you think that would be covered by the act? If so, whether it's going to have some kind of retention obligation on
personal accounts? Okay, so that is a very good question, and a question that gets at an issue. A complex issue that still, the nuances are frankly still being worked out. Government employee works at a government computer, and that government employee generally is spending most of his time on his government or her government computer doing government work and is occasionally sending emails to his wife. What is subject to the Open Records Act? Generally, as I think all of us who use computers in a for a corporation or an office, all of your email communications from your computers are subject to your employer's review, control, and access. And so there is the Open Records Act is generally built on the presumption that email that is received in your public capacity, at your government computer, is subject to the Open Records Act. It was received on a government computer by you while you were under the employee of the government. So that's a pretty strong standard. Not surprisingly, and I think understandably, a lot of government officials have develop their own personal email accounts, and that makes good sense. All of us have a personal life separate from our professional life, and that is certainly a valid decision to make. One of the things that's also occurred over time is that government officials are increasingly using their personal email for government activity. In other words, don't send that to me at my .gov email, send that to me at my AOL email. The Open Records Act also reaches into your private email when you are doing government work. In other words, one of the things that I think is excellent about the Georgia Open Records Act is it does not really try and decide whether this is an agency computer or not. What it is just trying focusing on is whether it was relating to your professional conduct, whether it was received or maintained in connection with the business of government. So even if an individual is using their private email to carry out their government function, it's going to be subject to the Open Records Act. And subject to an Open Records Act request. That's a long way of saying I do think they're subject to the Open Records Act request and accessible in response to a proper request.
I'll just add to that because I think it's interesting to note. I don't know if the Attorney General still carries two Blackberries, but a lot of state government officials, especially who have campaign work that they have to segregate from their or from their official government work, carry two phones or two devices, have two things, are very careful about how they segregate. The governor's office is very careful about that. So if someone is being sort of careless about that, then they really are mixing up, you know, official government business into their personal account. They You know, that could become sticky for them.
Mm-hmm. I just want to also point out that it is theoretically possible for a purely personal email to become public record. For example, if a government employee is spending 90% of their time on their government computer sending personal messages, then at that end, it does become a professional issue, and so it can go towards their conduct as their public, as their public conduct. So when I do trainings, I make sure and explain that there is a continuum of personal. There is no continuum of public. So depending on how much personal you're doing, it could become a public issue.
And it is routine for us to get, for the public, for an Open Records Act request to recover some personal email as part of the request, because you're working from a government computer.
Mm-hmm. But how do you determine that? How would it be enforced? In other words, if a county commissioner is using their personal computer and their personal email address to conduct county business to ensure that it's not subject to the open records law. For instance, the last time I had lunch with Shirley Lassiter before the FBI got her, she said, I'm not going to give you anything on my personal computer. And she said, I'm not conducting county business there. And I said, yes, I sent you plenty of emails to your personal email address, and they are subject to the open records law. She said, I'm not going to turn any of those over. And I've sent plenty of emails to our elected officials, and I don't get those back when I file open records requests. I only get the emails that are sent to their official email address.
Does every government official comply with an Open Records Act request for their personal email? And the answer is definitely not. But if they're, what I am comfortable with is that the way our Open Records Act is written, a court is going to require them to turn over email regarding their professional activities if the issue reaches the courts. And so it is a situation where if you know a government official is using their personal email to carry out government business, it is legitimate to submit an open request for all their government-related activities on their personal email. And if they fail to provide that information, to bring an Open Records Act claim based on it. But I think behind, sure, okay.
If you're the custodian of records, you've been designated to be a custodian, and you go out of the office, say on vacation, most attorneys take vacation during the summer for a week or two. If you have in your out-of-office reply, please follow up with this attorney. And let's say the person who submitted the request never follows up. Do you consider it good faith to have that in your out-of-office reply? And is that enough to say that it was received, but if no one ever got the request after that, if the person doesn't follow up, would you say that would be a...
So I guess the way...
I guess I want to know practically...
Practically, what I would suggest is not to do that, and instead to do that. The new law creates a system. If you want to create a custodian, you have to pretty aggressively put out the information about that custodian. And what I would suggest is that the Open Records Act email for that custodian, for Open Records Act, that you're publishing for Open Records Act request, should actually say custodian at atlanta.gov. And so that email then has to be monitored when the individual attorney is away for 2 weeks on vacation. Somebody else is gonna have to pick up that job and monitor that email. And it is, the idea of creating a custodian is, it is not the idea that it has to be one individual, but it has to be one designated office, in a sense, and that all the requests will flow through that person. But the flip side of that, the flip side of allowing that what will flow through that office, the flip side of that is this expectation that it can't ever go unmonitored. The law basically says somebody's got to be watching that individual address and email for requests, because the law is quite clear that being absent is not going to be an exception.
So would you come out better by not designating anyone at all?
I think I definitely believe that the way the law is set up, it really depends on your agency, but I think a lot of agencies will choose not to set up a custodian. Any other questions? Sure.
Under the old law, there were several cases that came down dealing with what's pending litigation. And For example, some of the cases suggested if you could discuss a formal demand letter, ongoing litigation, previous litigation between the parties, proof that the party has retained counsel, proof that the party has expressed an intent to sue. Do you believe the trend is to expand that or to curtail that with regard to discussions in open, in closed sessions on litigation?
So I think the trend, well, I think that the Open Records Act exception for attorney-client privilege, that's what we're getting here, right? Not the police exception. So the attorney-client privilege exception, the idea, I do think, and this, it's not an answer I'm particularly comfortable with, but the answer is that government attorneys were extremely uncomfortable with the limitations on the open records, on the attorney-client privilege, as they existed under the old law. And they were uncomfortable for them because, for example, if they knew an ordinance had been passed that was patently unconstitutional, and they wanted to tell somebody that it was patently unconstitutional, but there was no threat yet of litigation, they felt like they really, that their advice might end up being disclosed under the Open Records Act, and yet if the agency didn't take their advice, the agency didn't change the ordinance, then they had essentially put their client at grave risk because their advice that it was patently unconstitutional would become public, and that would facilitate a future litigant, even though they hadn't appeared yet, from bringing a claim. So I think that was the concern. And so I do think the Open Records Act attorney-client privilege exception is slightly broader to allow the legal conclusion of an attorney to be communicated and to be protected, even in the absence of anticipated litigation, as long as it's confined to the legal conclusion of the attorney, and that's validly given to a genuine client.
Mm-hmm. On the flip side, for the custodians, if a custodian has not been designated, or you can't find, you're looking at that agency that anybody has been, then I used to say to the custodian of the records, and if you're not it, please see to it that the custodian gets this. What is your suggestion for getting your request to the right person?
So that's an excellent question. So one of the problems that there used to be under the old law is you had to find the custodian. If you got the wrong custodian, you could actually end up hunting around for the right custodian for some time, trying to find out who the custodian was. The new law helps in that regard. You can designate a custodian, and we talked a little about that process, a designate a custodian for the entire agency. But if you don't designate a custodian for the entire agency, the new law also spells out various individuals that are required to receive an open records request on behalf of the agency. In other words, they include basically the top officials at the agency. And so, to a certain extent, it solves the custodian hunt issue. That top official, if he gets an Open Records Act request or she gets an Open Records Act request, it's at that point it's going to be their obligation to get that Open Records Act request to the correct employee who actually knows something about those individual records. So it's spelled out more clearly in the law. So I hope the custodian search is resolved.
And when you say the top of the agency, like if you're doing something with a county, it's the CEO of DeKalb, for example, or do you have to go to the personnel department if it's dealing with something there? Is it a department or is it the real top?
And so that gets a little bit to the question of what's an agency that another individual asked before, and that's a tough answer. So what would I do? I would encourage you to try and hit. If you're asking for something in the accounting department, I'd send it to the CEO and the head of the accounting department. But I do you don't need to, what's great is you don't need to get to the true custodian anymore, which was an unknowable thing under the old act.